First of all, thank you for inviting me to give a presentation here today. I have prepared a very long presentation and divided it into two sections. The first talk is going to be today. I'm giving another talk next Friday as well. First of all, I'm going to go through some of the toxicity testing assessment techniques that we can use, and a bit of background to all of this and how the field of ecotoxicology has been evolving over the last couple of decades at least. And then next week I'm going to show you some of the examples of the studies that we've been doing in my lab and collaborators' labs in Davis. So the title of the talk is Effect-Based Tools for Monitoring and Predicting Ecotoxicological Effects of Chemicals in the Aquatic Environment. And this is largely based on a paper with exactly the same title, which is why I chose that title, that Professor Jürgen Geist from the University of Munich and Inge Werner, who I'm sure several of you know or have met, was the director of the Aquatic Tox Lab at Davis. So a lot of times environmental toxicology and ecotoxicology get mixed up, and quite rightly so, since they both tend to have similar and overlapping contexts within each other. Environmental toxicology has a tendency towards looking at the effects of contaminants on individuals, and this includes human beings as well, or cells. Cells can also be treated as individuals or in vitro assays. So looking more at the effects at up to a whole organism. I think what ecotoxicology tries to do, take that further, and tries to link the effects that we can measure at individual organisms with that of what are the consequences at the population level, community, a community structure, and as a whole ecosystem. So ecosystem is currently a bit far-fetched. So within ecotoxicology, what we aim to do is look at responses, and we can measure responses to chemical insults or chemical exposure. And we can look at responses through exposure to pesticides and other contaminants at different levels of our biological organization. We can look at it from molecular responses, we can look at histopathology, the whole organs, the individuals. We can look at what's happening at the population level and communities in terms of community structures as well. But one of the challenges of ecotoxicology is to be able to link all these parameters, associate one with another to create a more predictive outcome or predictive approach to tell us what could be happening at the population level when we measure responses at genomics or histopathological responses itself. Now, there are a couple of arrows on this graph. There's one vertical for the y-axis and another the x-axis. The y-axis shows a mechanistic understanding, and the lower level of organization that we go towards, so if we look at molecules, we look at proteins responding to a contaminant, that gives us an understanding of how those contaminants actually affect these organisms. However, if the higher the biological organization that we look at, we get more ecological significance. This is a standard graph that I'm sure most of you have seen, if not all of you. So this is a nice example for Friday morning in preparation for Friday afternoon. As an example of what ecotoxicologists are trying to do is if we take a nice cold beer and pretend that it's already 5 o'clock, we can drink some beer, and we know that the liver is the organ that's or primary organ that will be metabolizing that beer and generating that response in the organism that makes us be more attractive and have a more successful approach in finding a mate, for example, but this could actually have huge consequences at the population level. that was supposed to be a little cartoon and comedy, but this is essentially what we're trying to do, is determine how many beers we can have before we start looking extremely virile as in this picture, and how would that affect the reproductive outcome. So what are the different steps? Can any links be created between these different steps at the different levels of biological organization? And that is the main challenge in ecotoxicology. As I said before, we can measure these responses at different levels, and on this slide, we see the molecules, the cells, detoxification enzymes, physiology, and so on. And I'm using the example of the Golden Gate Bridge here, and I put the fog there right in the middle because that is exactly the state that we're in at the moment. There is a lot of fog between our understanding of the links. Just because we see a response of a particular protein doesn't mean to say that that will translate to developmental reproduction. However, the field of endocrinology is probably one of the most advanced in being able to link this. So we know, for example, that a pesticide such as bifenthrin has estrogen mimicking properties, so it actually can mimic the response it will create. So if you expose a fish to bifenthrin, for example, at certain concentrations, you will actually see feminization. So the chemical itself is mimicking that. And with endocrinology, we can actually measure and are fairly certain that that will have impacts on the developmental life. Now, it's not bifenthrin that causes this. It's a byproduct of bifenthrin. So it's results from the metabolism of bifenthrin. I think it's hydroxybifenthrin, the metabolite that actually causes the feminization of male fish. So that's from a single contaminant perspective. We can start drawing conclusions. We expose it to a certain concentration, we will get a particular response. But the environment is not as simple as a single contaminant. In fact, it's very rare that you find a single contaminant acting on the different organisms. And we have a number of sources of contaminants. I'm using contaminants as a whole. Pesticides are a very small part of this contaminant. And we have a number of different sources, such as in this example here, we have agricultural runoff, rural homes, we also have construction that's on here. So you have non-point sources and things like wastewater treatment plant and factories, industry can result in point sources. So these are contaminants that are constantly poured into, in this case, the aquatic environment. And the point sources are, as it says in the figure legend, are far easier to identify than the diffuse sources. So I feel like I'm preaching to the converted here, but there are a number of effects or a number of parameters that will affect the action of the chemical. First of all, the one that we all know about is concentration and duration of exposure. That also determines the toxicity. Toxicity of a contaminant will be affected greatly by temperature, bioavailability, and whether or not that contaminant is soluble. And even more so, this graph here just shows a species sensitivity distribution. Each species has a completely different response, generally speaking, to a contaminant. It will respond at completely different concentrations. So within the environment, we are looking at a number of parameters that makes it very difficult to conduct these studies within a laboratory. These species sensitivity distributions are used generally to determine a protection factor that will determine a concentration that safely protects 95% of a species within an ecosystem. Now, there are different responses and different assessments that can be done. We can do acute and chronic exposure toxicity tests. And as we'd expect, on the left graph here, with an increase in concentration or dose, we'll have an increase in response. And this is something that we see at the acute toxicity level. And it's something that we would expect to see with most contaminants. However, when we start looking at the sublethal levels itself, the responses that we're measuring become non-monotonic. So the graph on the right-hand side, graph B, shows how there is a peak in response at sort of a medium high dose, and then the response starts dropping. So if we were to measure a parameter within this area where we have our controls on the y-axis, and then we just happen to pick a concentration which is high enough here, then, and we only look at those two concentrations, our assumption would be that there is no significant difference or no impact from that contaminant. Therefore, we have taken to start conducting serodilutions for any contaminants or any ambient water samples that we are testing. Now, the reason for this and an example of why this happens, we can go back to that beer example. So Friday afternoon, after a very long week, we are feeling stressed, and we start having a couple of beers, and that will take us to a level that will relax us. You can see that as an inverted U-shape. But beyond so many beers, we are no longer relaxed, so we are stressing ourselves again. So that's kind of the response that we see, and this is classic with endocrine disrupting chemicals. And I've been seeing it with a lot of responses at the gene level that are associated with swimming behavior and everything. You can get acceleration. The fish will, certain chemicals will trigger faster swimming up to a certain low level of concentration. You increase that and it starts to fly. So there's a lot of variation there. So, and that is at a level where you're looking at single contaminant. Mixture of contaminants are very important, but before going to mixture contaminants, they are environmental quality standards or approaches that can be established or used to establish environmental quality standards. And the classic approaches that we've been taking or are taken by US EPA and the Aquatic Tox Lab at UC Davis is conducting a three-tier or three trophic level toxicity testing. So we could look at algae, Daphnia, and fish, for example, and the different type of tests that we can do that will give us a particular safety factor, if you like. So you could do an acute toxicity test looking at the lethal concentration that will kill 50% of the organisms for these three different tiers. And that will give you a very high concentration, I suppose, on the immediate level to measure upon. However, that will be very, very extreme. And so there's a factor of 1,000 that would need to be divided by to be able to create a protection for those organisms in the field. You can improve on that safety factor in the analysis by doing, for example, a one long term, so you can do a chronic test on one species, with an invertebrate or fish species. And then that, because it's chronic, it's longer term, you get more of a safety factor. So you could divide that value by 100 and you're protecting the rest of the species. So, and so on, you could do two long terms, but the best is to have long term at least three species tests for a better safety, and then incorporate a species sensitivity distribution model within that to try and create a better safety factor. However, conducting chronic tests on, I think, certainly about two contaminants in the environment, conducting tests on the thousands and thousands of pesticides and contaminants that are out there, doing it on a chronic basis, it's just going to be impossible. So we can do the classes, we can do in species of interest, then we can use the most sensitive species to create a protection for the rest of them. However, the definition of sensitivity depends greatly on sensitivity to what. Salmonids, for example, can be very tolerant of certain contaminants, but at low oxygen, they're extremely sensitive. So that becomes very tricky as well in determining what species can be used and what cannot be used. Some of the model species that are used are good for preliminary information, but it's, I don't think they could actually be used for quality standards. So the aim is to do a more encompassing assessment where you can use the three-tier assessment, species sensitivity distributions, and even mesocosms for long-term study to create the standard. Now, when we're doing, so one of the techniques that is used is to take this toxicological data and put it into mathematical models that can actually, based on the chemical characteristics and the toxicity data that we have, we could create a mathematical model that will give us a toxicity exposure ratio, especially if you're integrating biological testing into that. Exposure assessments, what we are aiming to do is to predict the extent, the frequency, and the duration of which organisms are exposed to contaminants. Within the mathematical modeling, we can incorporate things like fate, transport, and bioavailability knowledge that we have on the contaminants. And that is based on us knowing that, or we can end up concluding that highly persistent contaminants with a high bioavailability will be the contaminants that are most at risk. That creates a problem in the sense that there are lots of less persistent contaminants that, say, have a half-life of 24, 48 hours, that because of that you will end up saying with a mathematical model that they are not so much of a risk. But if you have point sources of contaminants such as a wastewater treatment effluent or an urban area where you have irrigation or for a golf course, for example, the less persistent substances can sometimes be continuously applied, and so they become persistent in themselves, and we call them pseudo-persistent contaminants. And those are very problematic from perspective of using mathematical models. You can actually jump to conclusions that can result in being dangerous. So, and that is from a single contaminant. If you move to mixture contaminants, very little has been done, correct me if I'm wrong, but from the regulatory perspective of mixture of contaminants, mainly it's done on single substances. But And mathematical modeling can help there by using the chemical characteristics of a particular mixture with the toxicity data of each one of those mixtures, or each one of the components of the mixture, rather. And there are models out there that support concentration addition and independent action. And essentially, there are models that look into how additive are the contaminants. So if you have three contaminants, for example, and you have an acute toxicity for each one of them, an LC50 value for each one, you call that LC50 value a toxicity unit. If you divide each one, the concentration of each toxicity unit by three, you can mix a third of each contaminant together, and you'd end up with one toxicity unit comprised of those three chemicals. And this is the way it works. And that's a good tool except that they are confounding things such as synergism and antagonism that we don't know about. And the only way that we can find out about synergism and antagonism is currently by conducting biological tests. We need to test those effects within organisms and within a number of organisms. And we are doing some of these studies, and I'll talk to you about it next week a bit more. But not only synergism and antagonism, in some cases you can actually have suppression, which would be a good thing. An example of that is, I don't know if anyone here has taken statin drugs, but if you take statin drugs, the doctor will tell you not to have grapefruit. The grapefruit will actually suppress the action of the function of the statin drug, for example. So the approach that we are taking is to use the biological approach, looking at what is in our environmental samples, both in our field samples, if we expose them in vivo, do exposures in vivo, in vitro assays, and collecting that toxicity data, what can that tell us about reproduction? We can even do reproductive tests in this aspect. So the difference between the mathematical modeling is that we can predict a biological effect, but the biological can actually give you the actual measure effect. As I said, there are so many contaminants out there that we need multiple high throughput assays to be able to do this, and a lot of the in vitro tests allow us to do very rapid screening of a number of contaminants. And it can give us a clear cut of, yes, that needs to be looked into further, or we know that this has the effect directly. But the ideal scenario, obviously, is to combine chemical analysis, have a mathematical model in there with biological and toxicological assays. So this is just changing towards more of the approach that can be taken. So ecotoxicology has the main focus of it is ecological relevance. So we want to know what is the impact in the field. Currently, we can conduct two types of assessments or assays. We can conduct studies in the laboratory, and we can do some in the field. So within the laboratory, it's nice because we can have more reproducibility, specificity, we can control the test that we are doing. We can look at single substances, and we can also bring ambient samples. We can bring samples in from the field and expose the organisms there. And as I said before, we can conduct in vitro and in vivo tests. Within vivo, we can look at single species, and we can look at multiple species. We can even look at mesocosms, where we have not only multiple species, but the interaction within a community of those multiple species. From a field exposure environment, we can do in situ exposure. We can cage organisms, put them out of the river, and test them in situ. We can do something that's called ex situ, which Don has done as well, which is having a lab that is taken by a river. The water is basically pumped in from the river to our experimental design and then back out again. So that's, it's out there in the field, but it's not inside the system itself. Or we can use organisms that reside in the area that we are interested in sampling. We can expose these organisms or take the exposed organisms and use a number of methods to see what the impacts of that exposure is. We can use biomarkers, and there was a biomarker workshop at Davis a couple of weeks ago, which highlights a lot of different perspectives. I'm going to be talking a bit about that next week as well. And we can use just general pathology, what are the standard measurements that can be used. And on this graph, you have community indices as well. A lot of these are used very heavily in Europe, where using the population distribution of invertebrates can do the classification of water quality of streams and rivers. So I'm just going to go briefly through in vitro, in vivo, and the tests that we do. And an example of an in vitro test is something called Calox. And I don't know, have you heard of the Calox assays? So essentially, this is a cell-based assay in which they have, this is a human cell line. They have cloned luciferase, which is the luminescence gene that's expressed in the firefly. They have cloned the gene for luciferase into the human cell line and placed it downstream of CYP1A, which is a cytochrome P450 enzyme. So they placed it downstream of another enzyme. So when you expose these cells to contaminants that have estrogenic or androgenic, and they actually have different tests for this, when you expose them to the different contaminants, you have aryl hydrol receptors. So you have estrogen receptors that will bind chemical mimics, that will bind other chemicals to it. And if it has an effect that would be estrogenic, for example, it will trigger a cascade that will make the luciferase glow. And so you can actually measure in a 96-well plate whether or not that contaminant is estrogenic. And this is a matter of minutes, probably an hour test. You did it on a 96-well plate, so you can test serial dilution of a number of contaminants at the same time. Very straightforward, very fast screening for estrogen estrogenic compounds.
Is that read then in like a photometer, so you can measure intensity of those light that's being expressed?
Uh-huh. Are there problems with making sure that the cells don't get killed by the contaminants or what you're putting in?
So we do a serial dilution, and this is a very broad serial dilution. We do get mortality sometimes in the cells, but the measurements are done at very, very low concentrations. It varies on what you're testing, but part of these tests are looking at the number of viable cells at the end of the day as well, so that that's controlled that way as well. And there are other controls throughout the plate with the standard curves from using estradiol directly that are placed on there. And so with a standard curve, you can actually determine the concentration of the effect based on correlating or placing the luciferase activity, the signal that you're measuring from your sample, onto the actual estradiol. But yes, it's strong enough to measure whether a sample has an estrogenic effect or not at very, very, very low concentration where you can't even measure the contaminant for sure. So so it's a great tool for screening the activity of the chemical. However, it has its limitations from an ecological application perspective, because you're exposing a cell directly to it, so you don't have mechanisms that a fish would have to be able to avoid that reaching that target point in the first place. However, this is more direct. Within the fish, you could have a metabolism, say, of bifenthrin that is needed to get. So just because it doesn't have an effect doesn't mean to say it will not have an effect in an organism. But the nice thing about this is that if it does have an effect, it will likely have an effect. So these are just screening tools that we can do. So that's an example of in vitro tests. In vivo tests, these are what we are mostly familiar with, where you actually expose the organisms in tanks. These are some zebrafish in different tanks, exposing to different contaminants, serial dilutions of the contaminants. You can do acute tests, usually for fish, acute tests are 96 hours. You can do more chronic tests if you're looking at effects on endocrine disruption. generally the exposure would be about 14 days, 7 to 14 days. But you can also do continuous reproductive tests on these fish, and you actually count the number of eggs producing, the fecundity and viability, a number of other parameters. After these exposures, you can dissect the fish and do all sorts of biomarker assessments on them as well. And then this is one that I've recently got more and more involved in. I don't know how many of you here know of Simone Hassenbein. She's actually been funded by DPR partly on the project as well. And she's looking at the effect of pesticides in combination at different concentrations within a mesocosm environment. So it's out in the field, it's open to the elements. This is just an example photograph. Her tanks are actually open to the elements. And she's looking at how invertebrates can colonize tanks that are out in the field. So she's allowed the invertebrates to colonize the tanks. And then after a month of allowing them to stabilize within there, she's applied the pesticides and looked at how the community distribution has changed. What are the most sensitive species, what are the least sensitive species, and how does that affect the whole reproduction of these different organisms in the community. And she just finished October 31st, she just finished a 9-month mesocosm study, and she has some very, very complicated data that she's analyzing now. But she's very excited about it. It looks very, very interesting. So we should have some results on that by January, February. Yeah, that's good. So that's more from a laboratory environment where you can actually control what you're doing. We're lucky to have an in-situ test. The Department of Water Resources has it here. That's located at Hood. I'm sure you've all heard about Hood studies. It's a continuous monitoring station. And we have access to conduct exposures there as well. So we take tanks out there. We can place the fish. We can do in situ studies in a semi-controlled environment. So we can pump the water straight from the river into a tank and out again, and look at things like start off with mortality. We can look currently we're looking at just mortality and a number of biomarkers that indicate whether the immune system is affected, whether the nervous system and endocrine system are affected within these exposures. Linda Dianovic, I don't know if you're familiar with her, she's the manager of the Aquatic Top Lab at Davis, has been conducting a series of extremely laborious studies. She's going to be out there this Thanksgiving as well with her turkey and her fish on the pier. She's conducting back-to-back 14-day test exposures with fish out there, and we are assessing the different responses. And so far, the main responses that we are seeing are endocrine disruption. There's a lot of endocrine disruption there. So that's in situ, and that was rather ex situ rather than in situ. It's still in the location, but above it rather than inside. We've been wanting to do in situ per se, and then putting organisms in cages and putting them in the field. The logistics of getting a permit from the Department of Fish and Wildlife is, you're all laughing, you know what it's all about. So doing in situ studies is proving very tricky. So one of the things that we can do, and that's if we get take permits, is we can actually go out to the field and capture organisms directly from there. We can bring them into the lab and do a lot of biochemical and molecular assays on them to see their health condition of it. Suite is currently doing a number of studies, Suite at UC Davis as well, is doing a number of assessments on Delta smelt at the moment. Currently, I am not involved in any of the monitoring aspects, but I'm still developing and validating techniques to be included in that. Which brings me more to my field of expertise, and we're nearing 11 o'clock, so good timing. So I'm going to be talking to you more about this next week, but my interest in ecotoxicology is more from the mechanistic perspective, and it's how do organisms respond to contaminants? And more importantly, how is it that the Delta smelt is still alive out in the area, and they're not dead since they're so sensitive? But how does an organism become more resistant or tolerant of a contaminant than others? How and why? And so I use genomics, so use gene expression, which sequence the transcription, transcriptome, as in all the mRNA, all the genes of a number of species in the Delta, and developed a tool called microarrays, which you're probably familiar with. Part of one of the first studies conducted on pesticide development, currently doing a whole genome assessment of that pesticide to see what the effects are. So we're looking at starting off with the mechanistic responses of exposure, trying to link them with measurements that we can take of the whole organism, and link them with the population. And on this slide, you'll see a couple of arrows there with dotted lines towards the bottom of the community and ecosystem. That is what I call a bit far-fetched at the moment with the mechanisms to community and ecosystem, but we can infer and understand effects, mechanistic effects that go to the population level. We can start understanding what the adverse outcome pathways are within an entire system biology, as in looking at different aspects more holistically rather than just taking one measurement and trying to get information. And where my research is currently going is trying to collaborate with as many people as possible with different fields of expertise and do not thousands of experiments, but do a few very concise experiments where, say, Don Weston gets the feeding aspect of it, working on the invertebrates, I would work on the fish of it, we get someone else to work on phytoplankton. So we have the three different tiers, trophic levels there. But not only that, how do they interact with each other? What are the mechanisms affecting one another and themselves within the actual system? I'm going to stop there. I'm going to start next week's talk with ecotoxicogenomics. So you have ecotoxicology, if you put some genes in there, you have ecotoxicogenomics.